Good evening, everyone. Can I please have a quick sound check before we begin? I want to make sure that you guys can hear me and also if you could see the share screen. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. All right, we have a jam-packed house tonight. Where are you guys from? Can you type in, hey, Lori? We have been close to 12 hours trading. Robert, New York City. All right. Where's everybody from? I am in North Detroit, Michigan at the moment. All right. North Carolina, Maui, Massachusetts, Phoenix, Arizona, 104 degrees. Wow. Ann Arbor, Michigan, Memphis, Tennessee, UK. Hey, Dan, where are you at in UK? My nephew's in London. All right. Wow, Minnesota. All right. Oh, wow. Awesome. London. Okay. Ontario, Canada. I'm like 30 minutes from the border. Brian, I'm 30 minutes away from Sarnia. Okay. Playa del Carmen. Okay. All right. Stop right there, Chris. Stop right there. That is too much fun. Love Mexico. Haven't been in Mexico in a couple of years. Okay, guys. So let's get started. If you're very new, this is not going to be your typical presentation. Okay. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name is Anka Metcalf. I'm the CEO and founder of TradeOutLoud.com. I have been trading for more than 20 years. For the last 18 years, I have been a professional trader, just focused on day trading and swing trading, trading my own accounts. I have also traded other individuals' accounts as well. And I have been trading professionally for as long as I can remember. And prior to becoming a professional trader, I also worked in investment banking for about 10 years before diving on my own into trading and creating my own income, trading the markets every single day. Yep, I have my footprints all around the market. For those of you that don't know who TradeOutLoud is, TradeOutLoud is the company that is specialized in educating individuals how to trade, how to day trade, swing trade, actively invest in the Forex and the equities markets. Based on our methodology, you can trade anything on the planet, including cryptocurrencies, Forex, anything. Okay. So today's presentation is not going to be about slides. No, it's just going to be charting. So we're going to look at charts. I'm going to tell you some of my daily trading routine. And I'm going to share with you my daily routine. And also I'm going to share some other important elements that you need to take into consideration before you actually look at charts. We're going to be analyzing the current market environment post FOMC, right? So I thought about, you know, creating an event that is going to talk mostly about charts, but I didn't want to do it before the FOMC meeting. So now that we have the FOMC meeting out of the way, I think we're going to have a really good go at this. All right, we're going to take a look and see if we have any trading opportunities tonight in the futures markets. And I will point out exactly precisely what I'm looking at and also the setups, how we came to that conclusion and all the fun stuff, all the analysis behind the scenes. Also identifying hi-hats patterns, what you need to have, the ins and outs. We're going to review the execution of the strategy and parameters, the importance of a trailing strategy. So what happens when you achieve target one? How do you establish targets when you have an active trade? When do you calculate those targets and how you calculate those targets? I will be sharing in tonight's presentation. And what to do after you exit the trade, because a lot of traders, you know, if they have a losing trade, they close the trade and then, you know, kind of like they go on, right? You know, start licking their wounds in the corner. But what happens if you have a winning trade? Well, you pretty much have to do the same homework as you do if you have a losing trade. So at the end of each trading session, I have been doing this, like I said, for more than 18 years. this is a very important part of the process. So after the trade closes, I analyze it and I see what was it that I did that worked in that specific strategy, and what is it that did not work in that specific strategy. And tonight's presentation, this last chapter that we're going to revisit, what to do after you exit the trade, is going to take your trading to the next level. You're not going to need probably another coaching session, because you're going to be your own mentor and you're able to recognize the mistake that you did. Maybe you did, maybe you didn't, maybe you did a mistake, or maybe you have not done any mistakes. So, and again, this is a very important step. And I know that a lot of traders are driven to coaching and they go like, okay, I'm going to get some coaching sessions because I think that if I get one or two lessons or one or two coaching sessions, I'm going to propel my trading. But it's all about analyzing what you were doing in the market. And this is something that you can do on your own. So you should not be spending any money on that. All right. So we're going to dive in to charts. Okay. So let me know if you guys can see the screen right now. I'm displaying, just give me one sec. All right, so I'm displaying one big fat chart. Okay, you guys can see it. Okay, cool. All right, okie dokie, that sounds good. Okay. All right, first of all, I want to take you, so before we actually dive into charts, let's take a revisit the routine, right? Oh, and by the way, this session is being recorded and the archive link will be sent out later on tonight after the presentation. So estimated time of the presentation, about 45 minutes. So I'm not going to keep you guys in here a very long time. So we're going to tap upon these topics and then we're going to be off. All right. So before I start any kind of trading decision, I collect my information. Okay, so I like to look and see if there is anything on an economic calendar, anything that is, for example, on schedule for release for that day, and especially now, for example, in earnings season. All right, so one thing that I do is, and I'm sharing this with you guys, one thing that I love to do in the morning is actually navigate towards the economic calendar. I get my economic calendar from forexfactory.com, so write it down. Do you guys see it? Do you guys see the chart now? Okay, cool. Okay, so this is my daily routine, okay? So I come in from the computer and then I look at the daily calendar. So I look to see if there has been any data in the overnight and then how the overnight has reacted to that specific data. And then I look at the day ahead because I'm only basically trading the New York trading session. For those of you that really do not know me and have never traded with me, I only trade 2 hours or less. Okay. So again, this week we were, because we are trading in earnings season, the activity in the market is really high. So I was literally done in less than 2 hours, really less than 2 hours. I was done probably 10 o'clock or 10:15. We were done trading. So I look at the economic calendar and I try to identify news releases that have high impact or medium impact or low impact. Definitely the high impact news releases, the big majority of the releases are being out actually at 8:30 a.m. Whether it's the advanced GDP that we're going to have tomorrow, whether it is the core CPI, whether it is unemployment claims or whatever you may have on the agenda, that is coming, the big bulk is coming in at 8:30. And you can see here, so we're prepping right now. Hey, Tammy. So right now you're seeing that we're basically prepping for the overnight trading session. So I know many of you guys may be in Australia. I saw Melbourne in here. I saw Sydney in here. So a lot of you guys may be looking at the overnight markets for trading opportunities. And this is a really good idea to see, you know, how a trader preps, for example, for the Asian session and for the London session, not necessarily for the next day. So in case you want to prepare for the overnight trading session, there's a little funnel here that you can click on. And of course you will have to select all the other, not Canada, but you will have to select China, Europe, UK, definitely New Zealand, and Japan. And you hit apply filter and you're going to have all of the news releases that will be generated in the overnight. So you can see that we have a bunch of low impact releases in the overnight trading session for Thursday. So all of these yellow little files, folders right here are low impact. So that means that they're not going to have any kind of price impact. So they are not capable of moving the price around. So that means that we're pretty much going to have an instinct session, a quiet session, and most likely a trending session, because if the prior session was trending, the likelihood of trend continuation is really high. When we do not have news releases, that will interfere with price action. Okay, so as you can see, the overnight trading session is very quiet. So Thursday, really low impact releases. And the only high impact release is going to be at 8:30. 8:30 is going to be the catalyst for the entire trading session. Now at 8:30, I don't trade before the market opens. So I like to see the influx of the open at 9:30, and I like to trade 2 minutes into the 9:30 going into the next 2 hours. I'm also noticing that tomorrow we have pending home sales. So remember that this 8:30 release is highly to impact the price from 8:30 into the open. And when the New York trading session opens, we will see a really high influx of contracts that are going to hit the market either to the upside or to the downside based upon the release that was at 8:30. Okay, so the next release is coming at 10 o'clock. Now, as you guys know or may not know, the market goes through a certain rhythm. So when the market opens, you are having the opening tick, you're having the opening aspect of the market with the regular fleecing effect. The fleecing effect is because it's going up and down, up and down, up and down. A lot of times the price is just getting a run. Oftentimes you're getting, and especially in earnings season, you're having runaway price, whether to the upside or the downside. If you're not having any releases or any high impact earnings, then guess what? You're going to probably see the price action that is going to not be dominant and not pick a direction. So at 10 o'clock, we have the pending home sales. If we have a bullish activity, if these numbers, and we're not trying to predict, we're not trying to forecast anything. We're just reading the data at the time of the release, and we're interpreting we're letting the price interpret the release and picking a side, whether bullish or bearish. So after this release, after this high impact release, we're into 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock is a major reversal time in the market. So if we have a bullish aspect, for example, from 8:30, that moves into 10 o'clock, at 10 o'clock, the likelihood of a pullback is really high. So I'm going to trace some of those strategies for you guys. If we have a down market from 9:30 till 10 o'clock, the likelihood of the pullback, so let's say a dead cat bounce, right, is really high. Depending on the price action and the levels that we're getting on any specific days, because right before the open, remember, we have all the data from the Asian session and from the London session. We have a bunch of data. Okay, so I'm going to show you a little trick when we go to charts of if you are, let's say, for example, if you are a New York trading session trader, how you can form your bias based on only one candlestick. And how crazy is that, right? Okay, so now that we know and we have collected the data, again, I don't assume anything ahead and I don't interpret the data. I don't forecast the data. So what I do is I watch my price levels in reaction to how the price is interpreting the news. And this is pretty much it for tomorrow, right? So we're going to steer free and clear for the rest of the day. Now remember that on Friday Friday is actually the last trading day of the month. That's it. It's the last trading day of the month. We're going to get brand new monthly candles, brand new weekly candles. And of course, on Monday, we're going to get brand new daily candles. But one of the most important things is that we get brand new monthly candles. And based upon the shape of the candle, based upon whether it is a dominated bullish area or is it a dominated bearish formation, we may have continuation or rejection of price. And I'm going to show you, it sounds a little sophisticated, but it's not. It's actually very simple when I'm going to show you on charts. Okay. All right. So now that we have all this data, what else are we missing? Can anybody tell me? Can anybody tell me? What do we need to know right before the open? What do we need to know right before the open? There's one more thing that we need to know. Can anybody guess? Anybody? Okay, I'm going to give you guys quite a few seconds here. All right. Dan, yes and no. Okay, do me a favor, guys. If you can please select all panelists attendees so everybody can see what you guys are typing, that would be really helpful. All right, for full transparency. All right, the one thing that we need to know, guys, is earnings. Okay, what are the earnings? What are the earnings? Tomorrow's the 29th, okay? So I'm going to go to the 29th. These are the earnings before the market opens. So I try to go a night before through the earnings and try to identify which are the companies that have highest impact, that may have a high impact for the market. And I only found one, which is MasterCard, MA. So MasterCard is not really likely to impact the market that much, right? So we're pretty much based upon the economic releases that we have. And based upon the fact that we do not really have a ton of companies that will be reporting earnings that will have really high impact in the market, I think that we're going to have a pretty quiet overnight trading session. We have AstraZeneca, we have Merck, we have, like I said, Overstock.com. We have MasterCard that will be reporting tomorrow before the open. Tomorrow after the close, we have a lot of earnings, amongst which a heavy influencer within NASDAQ, and that is Amazon. Amazon is a big player in NASDAQ, so therefore that will create a lot of price gyration in NASDAQ, okay? We also have Pinterest, also NASDAQ, okay? We have Twilio for tomorrow, we have Gilead, Guild, we have T-Mobile, et cetera, but these two are going to be the most important earning reports for tomorrow, but they're happening after the close. Now, if you have earnings that are happening after the close, okay, if you have earnings that are happening after the close, they are likely to impact the open into the next day. So for example, we had earnings in Apple, AMD, Microsoft, and Alphabet last night that had a really high impact into a short squeeze in NASDAQ yesterday, because NASDAQ yesterday had a bit of a pullback right in the New York trading session, and then it rotated and went back up again into an inflection time. And that was at 2 p.m. So these are the things that you need to watch for. First of all, this is the daily routine. Number one, you check your economic releases based upon the time that you're trading. You're going to select either the US data, if you're not trading overnight or if you're not looking at the overnight data, you're selecting just the US data because that is going to be your major concern for the trading session. And the next thing that you're going to be checking, definitely the earnings, right? So you're going to watch the companies that will be reporting tomorrow. And that's pretty much it on the economic front and also on the earnings front. After you have collected all the data, guess what, guys? It's time for multi-time frame analysis. And what I typically do is I start with my highest time frame possible. And my highest time frame possible, let me just erase some of the levels right here. Okay, let's do this. All right. So I start with the monthly chart. Now, remember, we have two more trading days, Thursday and Friday, and this candle is going to close. All right. So this candle is in the books. Friday is going to be a little bit of choppy, wishy-washy, because it's a calibration day. All right. All the data is going to go in the books, whether you made money or whether you lost money. And all that data is going to be history going into Monday. Now you see this candle right here. When I analyze the overnight trading session, and remember, I'm a day trader. Okay. So I'm a swing trader as well. I'm also an investor, but this class is mostly focused on swing trading and day trading. So for example, if I see that the price is really elevated, right? I look at where is it elevated into. You cannot see the chart. Oops. Okay, here we go. All right. How about now? Robert, can you see the chart? Can everybody see the chart? So please let me know if you guys, okay. All right, there were some really small issues with the projector, but everything seems to be working fine. Okay. All right. So the first thing that I look at is I look at where are we trading right now? Okay. Where are we trading right now? So definitely today we closed into the 978. Okay. This is where we closed. Or basically this is where we open right now, because it's already 721. Wow. Where did this day go? This day flew by so fast. Okay. So I'm looking at where the price is trading right now, and also looking at the price, where is it trading in relation to the prior month high and prior month low? Because this is very important, because the prior month high always will serve as some kind of support level for the ongoing price action, especially if the price is trading above. So now that the price, now that the price is trading above June's high, we know that we had a really nice rally into July. I mean, it wasn't like an extraordinary rally, but it was, the price was higher, not by much, but it was higher. So you can see here that every single time when we get price action continuation, and this is how you read price action, you get price action continuation for higher, you're always going to assume that going into the next month, if you have, for example, another bullish environment that will challenge this prior high, the 15,134, we're talking about NASDAQ, we could talk about S&P, or we could talk about any chart, whether it's a stock chart, cryptocurrency chart, or whatever it is. So typically, if into the month of August, we start taking out the prior trading month. So in August, if we do something like this, okay, and if we trade above this prior high, okay, if we trade above, and these are technicals, guys. If we trade above this prior high will serve as support. And this is going to be a really big support for ongoing price action. Another thing that I look at is the level of extension. So where are we trading at? Are we trading into resistance? Are we trading extended from support? So where's the price trading in relation to all these elements? So I can see that right now we have a low. Oops, sorry. Let me just erase these because we don't need them anymore. Okay, so right now we can see that we're trading into a low, right? We have a low, we have already formed a low. So basically this is going to be the game plan as we're moving forward into the month of August. Now remember, month of August is usually kind of like a trending month, all right? And as we're going into September, the choppiest months are September and October. October is by far the most volatile month of the year. You can read that everywhere. It's the most volatile month of the year. So if you want to take off and you want to go on vacation, go in October, okay? Go in October. September is also a choppier to trade. So we can expect a lot more continuation going in August. And if we're going to have any kind of divergence in the market, any kind of pullbacks in the market, we're expected to have those in September and October. And you're going to ask, why September? Well, in September, you're going to have the end of the quarter, which is going to create the contract roll in the futures indices. So all these futures indices are going to roll into the December contract, and that is going to happen mid-month. You're going to have quadruple witching option expiration. That is going to be the third Friday of the month, third Friday of the month. So there you go. You have three elements that are really important. And then you can have a little bit of relief into the last week with a little bit of window dressing. So returning back to this chart, okay, returning back to this chart, if the month of August is going to prove that it can take out the high. So contingent on the fact that we're not going to get another high, let's say tomorrow or the day after tomorrow. Let's say 134 is going to be the high, okay? If we violate and if we come in, okay? So if we generate some kind of red activity throughout the month of August that is going to violate this prior low, we're going to start coming in, okay? And we're going to start coming in, and that will create a sell area. Oops, sorry. I meant to pick up the red candle, okay? So we're going to have a red candle that is most likely going to start revisiting this 10 exponential moving average. Why the 10 exponential moving average? Well, the 10 exponential moving average, because every single time we came in, we rallied. Every time we came in, we rallied. Every time we came in, we rallied. Okay. And this is the pandemic low right here. This is the pandemic low right here, last year in March. So you can see that right after this rotation happened, you see how this rotation happened? We have 1, 2 down, retested the 50, the 20, the 10, got hooked into these lines and then rallied. And then ever since, remember guys, this is a monthly chart, okay? So every single time the price started to move higher, right? The price started to move higher. Look at this. It got a little bit elevated. At one point it was trading right into this high. It pulled back to the 10 exponential moving average. And then it rallied again. Look at these dojis right here. It rallied again. And then where did it pull back to? It pulled back to the 10 exponential moving average. And then it rallied again, right? So you can see that the price is getting a little bit extended as we're moving higher right now. So this is going to be the first clue. If the price will break the July low, so in August, if the price is going to break this low right here, we are going to come back and we are going to be bearish, okay? We are going to be bearish from this low all the way to the 10 EMA. Because at this point, we're more likely to come back down to the 10 EMA and then start a rally. So we're going to be bearish into the 10 EMA. So from this low, this July low all the way to the 10 EMA, and then we are going to be, guess what? We're going to be bullish again from this low higher, okay? From this low higher, we're going to be bullish again. And you're going to ask why? Because it's chart pattern repetition. We move up, we pull back. We move up, we pull back. We move up, we pull back, okay? So this is pretty much, you know, what I'm looking for at higher time frames. And every single time when I trade, and especially I do a macro analysis on weekends, and this is what I look for. So I look for these specific areas on my technical chart that will point out to a bias, if you will. Okay. So this is the monthly chart. So the monthly chart is a little bit extended because you could see that it caught a bubble of air between the 10 EMA and the low of this month. So this is called a tradable void. So if we break below this low right here, we're going to fill up this void. So we're going to be bearish all the way to the 10 EMA. And once we get into the 10 EMA, we're going to be back bullish. Okay, not complicated. All right, now it's time to go one step further and try to look at the weekly charts. Weekly charts, every single candle represents 1 week of trading activity. The monthly chart represents 1 month of trading activity. So when I go to the weekly chart, I like to zoom in a little bit more. And because we had such an extreme move to the upside, I like to see if the price is nearing some kind of extension levels based on the prior drama pullback. I call it a drama pullback, okay? This is a drama pullback that we have. This is the pre-pandemic high, and this is the pandemic low, all right? So I like to use my Fib tool, and I like to trace my levels to see, are we trading into an extension level? Okay. So you can see here that we have tapped this week back into support into the 261.8% level, and then we bounce back up. So this week we are trading above the prior week's high, not by much, but just enough to put us on the bullish side. So because we have had that high recorded, for example, in NASDAQ, because we're talking about NASDAQ right now. Okay, just because we have this new high right here, we are looking for pullback buy opportunities. Okay, and we will be looking for pullback buy opportunities going into tomorrow's trading session. Okay, and remember, this is a weekly chart. Just by the fact, just by looking at the candle and seeing that we have a brand new high. Now, the other thing that I look at when I look at charts, I look at support levels. Where do we have support levels? Okay, so I know my moving averages are dynamic and flexible support levels for, and they serve, they serve as, for example, trend lines. If the price is moving higher or lower, I know that as long as the price is remaining above the 50, above the 10, above the 20, above the 50, these are going to be buy zones. When the price is trading off of the 10 exponential moving average, it's more likely to become a power trend. Okay, so power trends on the weekly charts are extremely important, because if they respect the 10 EMA, that is the power trend definition, for this chart, then the price is likely to continue higher. Now, as you could see last week, we had a pullback right into this 10 exponential moving average, and then we rallied. This week, we made a brand new high. So the next thing that I'm going to ask myself is, you know what, if we get a pullback beyond this 10 EMA, where are we going to go? Okay, where are we going to go? So I also look at the prior resistance levels and prior support levels, because these are very important. And I can see that there's a resistance level right here. Okay, you can see it. There's that resistance level that is going to impact price. This resistance is now going to become support. Ongoing support. So if the price is going to start retracing and getting, for example, and you know, if we violate last week's low, let's say we're going to land here close to 14,000, because that would be the next area. Okay. That would be the next area. Now we're trading at 15,000. Okay. At 15,000. That's a really big swing to the downside. But as you can see, we're still holding the 10 EMA, but contingent on we filling up this void and moving lower, this is the next minor support. Prior resistance forms minor support. So again, here from the weekly chart, if we're going to have some support levels violated that are super close to the weekly lows from this week or the weekly lows from last week, then we know that we can enter a bearish environment to 14,000. But from 14,000, we're going to be bullish again, right? We're going to be bullish again, because this is resistance becoming support that is going to take the price much higher. Why do you think that is? Because we are trading into a massive uptrend. What other things do you see on this technical chart? Well, you see that the price is trading off of the 10 EMA. You can also see that the price is kind of locking in to the 20 SMA. So it kind of likes this 20 SMA. Guys, look at the technical charts and let your technical charts speak to you. You got to let the charts speak to you. Okay. Have time. And also when you look at technical charts, don't look up close. Definitely this is not the way to do it. I see some traders do this. Okay. And they have like these big candles right here. You really don't see the trend. You don't see anything on these candles, right? Make sure that you zoom in so you see all the technical picture. Okay. Zoom in, you see everything. And then you can see that the price loves to rotate off of the 20 simple moving average. You can see repetition here. You can see it right here. You can see it right here. You can see it right here. So since last year, this has been the common denominator. So it pops up, it comes back down to the 20, pops up, goes back down to the 20. You can see here that once it came into the 20, then it gravitated for a few weeks, right? Into the 10 EMA, and then it pulled back again. We're kind of like into this area right now where the price is getting very extended from the 10. So it's kind of like high time that we're going to get a pullback. Okay. So the next thing that I look at is, okay, so if we're not going to get a pullback, and if next week, let's say on Monday, we're going to start trading above 134, where are we going to go? This is why I have these levels for me. These are long-term. So I use a lot of sets of Fibonacci's. I use sets that are on the monthly. I use sets that are on the weekly. I use sets that I use off the daily for different target objectives. This is a high time frame objective. This is a target objective that you would trade a quarterly chart. This is a target objective that if you are investing in NASDAQ. Okay, so if you're having a really long-term trade. And as you can see here, the next profit target is 20,000. Now, I had a class last year, and we were talking, I think it was in April of last year. I think I still have the recording somewhere. I think it's on YouTube somewhere. And I did discuss that once we had this rotation happen here, I said that if we're going to break above the high, we're going to go to 11,000, 12,000, we're going to go to 15,000. And then we have a huge void into 20,000. Guys, we're more than halfway there. More than halfway there. And this was more than a year and a half ago. So it's not like I'm making predictions. I am calculating the odds of price action and pre-mapping the trades. Okay. So that's what I'm doing. I'm not doing anything else. Okay. So the next thing that I do is I go further onto a daily chart. The daily charts, and remember that I told you guys that there is one candle that is going to light the way. And that is always your prior candle on the daily. So watch the prior candle. You see where we're trading right now into the 982. If we trade above this high, we're gone. Boom, higher. We're not only going to go higher and challenge the 15,125, but we're more likely to take out the 134. Okay, so we're likely to continue higher. Now, as you could see today, we had a digestion day. What is a digestion day? It's a day that doesn't challenge the high and it doesn't violate the low. So it's pretty much contained, which is pretty normal for an FOMC day, okay? It's pretty normal for an FOMC day. So we have some electrifying price action in today's action off smaller timeframes that I will show you. But if you're, for example, a swing trader, okay, this is the chart where you go like, stop. I don't need smaller timeframes. So you analyze the monthly, you analyze the weekly, you analyze the daily, and you go, stop. This is it. Okay, I'm not going to go any further. I'm not going to zoom in any further because I don't need to. So I know that if I trade above this prior high because of the massive uptrend that I'm in, we are going to go higher. Okay, we're going to go higher. This is the high. So the exact level that I will look for a bullish swing, for example, would be 15,075 over this candle high. So over 075, I will look for a long. As long as we're still trading into this area, we're going to be looking for a long. So if I'm looking and my entry would be based only on this level, I'm not going to buy it here. This does not represent a trigger price for me. A lot of traders say, hey, you know what? I know this is the trigger, but I'm going to get in early and I'm going to have a really tighter risk because if I'm going long here, by the time I'm getting back into the trigger, I'm already in the money. Wrong. You may be in the money, but there's nothing at this level that is going to have high odds for your trade. You either are bullish above or bearish below, period. That's it. Okay, there are no, I'm going to get in early, I'm going to jump in the trade. No, you either get it at the trigger or you don't get it at all. And the trigger is going to be above this high. And very careful about the bearish side to this because you're going to be bearish from 0.59 probably to 825. Okay, at which point you're going to be bullish again. Why do you think I'm going to be bullish, guys? Because as you could see here, okay, as you can see here, we popped over the 20 SMA and price history proves that the price loves to root and pivot into the 20 SMA before it goes higher. So watch the overnight trading activity and look for higher price action. So now that I have determined my entry, now second step to determine what my stop is. a lot of traders, when they see these inside bars, and this would qualify as a sandwich for tomorrow's trading session, would be to use the low of this candle, just below the low of this candle, below the low, okay? Not at the low. And then you will look, the last thing that would be on the menu would be to look for a target level. So in order to determine targets into all-time high, beyond all-time highs, you're gonna go back to the tool, back to the FIB tool, and you're gonna be using projections. However, you still have a prior high into the 134. So if the price is going to get above this candle high, the 15.0075, the first target that I'm going to be looking for is 15,134, okay? And beyond this point, I'm gonna go to the most recent pullback low and high and analyze how it traded. Now, I know we're trading into new highs, but we don't have a pivot yet here that I can base my FIB decision on. So in this particular case, I'm gonna take the most recent swing high and low because they're all already formed. I cannot use the FIB at this level since we don't have any kind of pivot. We have red candle, inside candle, and no activity right now. If we would have traded above 0.75, then I can use this for further targets, but because I don't have it, I'm going to be using the prior pivot high and low, and we don't have that much price difference. So as you can see that based upon this prior high and the prior low, because we have traded over this 100% retracement, this was the first target into the 134, okay? 134, so you can see here, bingo, target achieved. And then when we came back, I don't know if you guys can see this. Let me see if I can zoom in a little bit here so you can see the levels. All right, here we go. All right. You can see here that we have a massive confluence level based on which yesterday when I was teaching one of the courses that that we have on a monthly basis, the Power Income Futures Day Trading course, I started, you know, I was so excited about the level that I saw into the 785 that I called a long. I even forgot to turn on the recorder. Okay. Hey, Ray, look for 3 to 4. Okay. So I forgot to turn on the recording and I went like on and on for about 30 minutes, you know, looking at charts, analyzing charts and say, hey, this is the long, this is the long. Okay. This is the long. Most of the traders got in. Okay. Hey, Kevin, Kevin, you got it, right? Guys, don't forget all panelists and attendees. Kevin was in class and he got the trade. Okay, Kevin was in class and he got the trade. I was so excited about that trade that I totally forgot to turn the recorder on. Okay, of course, anytime, Ray, feel free to ask anything. It's like, this is like, guys, this is a session that we talk about charts, we talk about entries, we talk about anything you guys want. I don't want it to be like PowerPoint stereotype. Let me show you how great futures trading is. Oh, let me tell you what fantastic trade I had today in XYZ. No, it's about reading the charts and having a game plan for the next day, okay? All right, so if we happen to trade above this all-time high, these would be the targets, okay? This would be the targets. And you could see here that we have a closer target into 15,336. And then we have wowzers extension into 15,887. Okay. So these are the targets that we can expect for NASDAQ contingent on taking that all time high out. Okay. All right. What happens if you're a day trader? Well, if you're a day trader, let me take these, readjust them. Okay. Now, if you're a day trader, you're going to start doing a little bit more analysis. Okay. So you're going to have to dive in to the 4 hour. Okay. You're going to have to dive into 4 hour and you're going to give it, let me just give it a little bit of data here because it only has 4 days. Let me give it 90 days. Okay. Here we go. All right. So can anybody tell me what trend this is? Can anybody tell me what trend this is? Are we in an uptrend or a downtrend? All right, uptrend, you guys rock. Yes. Hey, Tammy. Okay, so we're in an uptrend. So what happens in uptrends? What do we do in uptrends? Do we buy or sell? buy or sell in uptrends? Do we buy or sell? You buy, we buy. So every pullback becomes buy, but we buy the dip, we buy the dip, we buy every single dip, right? Okay, so what happens if we are like right here in the middle, right here in the middle? What's gonna happen here, okay? We also see, I'm gonna zoom in a little bit because we need to watch price, okay? We need to watch the price. So I'm gonna start tracing some levels for you guys, okay? So number one, I'm going to put in some support levels, okay? So I see this high, and this high is more likely to create support, right? Because once resistance, this is resistance right here, this is resistance, okay? Now becomes support for ongoing price action, even if we have a little bit of a dive down here, but this is going to be support. And you can see here that the price is trying to hold support. Now, why isn't the price going higher? Because it has resistance from this 20 SMA right here. It also has resistance. Let me just get a straight line. Okay. You can see here, see these lows right here? This whole area, okay, is a tough area to handle for price. So what price needs to do at this time, you could see the price, you could still see the price bubble, right? The price needs to start closing above this area. So the price needs to take out that whole resistance. And once it closes above this area, it will have velocity. And at that point, the price will continue higher. Okay, it will continue higher. So it needs to go level by level by level by level. Okay. What happens if it doesn't? Okay, what happens if it doesn't? Now, this resistance will also act. So once the price crosses below support, this support is going to become resistance again. And if the price is going to start moving down below this level, you can see it right here, below this level, it can potentially continue lower. And on any pullback and on any price rejection from the same support level, prior support level, now resistance, can come back down. And then you will have that, option, right? That we discussed from the weekly chart, that if we take out prior week's low, we are going to start to come in. And then if we take out the low of July, we can start coming in. And it all can start like this, okay? So we have to be very careful. So what is the game plan? Okay, so what will be the game plan for, let's say, tonight? Okay, for tonight, for the overnight trading session. And watch this video watch this video tomorrow morning, okay? Watch this video tomorrow morning. Remember, this is a line of resistance that is going to have really high impact. Based upon price action, we have some levels here that are going to be very important because they have been tested. This is going to be the bullish above level right here. So just above the FOMC candle high, you see this doji right here? This is going to be bullish. This is going to be bullish above. And everything from this point is going to be like a matter of time before it skyrockets. I like I said, I don't think 134 is going to be a big deal. It's going to be taken out like in no time. All right. And let's talk about the bearish level. If we, in the overnight trading session, we take out this 14,900, we can start going lower. The next level that we go is probably going to be into this prior low right here. This is going to be the support level. We have a confluence level as well. And if we violate this level, we're going to go back into this 200 simple moving average. This is going to be the decision line. If the market is not going to bounce, if NASDAQ is not going to bounce off of this level, it's done. It's done. Okay. It's done. Because we will be back. See here, this is Monday's low. All right. So we came in. This is the bigger picture. We rallied. We pulled back, and this is a shallow pullback. And right now we're like right in the middle, right? We haven't taken out this high. We haven't taken out this high. But if we take out this blue line, which is into the vicinity of 15,100, we are bullish. So this is going to be the line in the sand for tomorrow, okay? And for tonight in the overnight trading session, okay? So we're going to be basically bullish above this level, and we're going to be bearish below 14,900. These are going to be the levels, because right now the price is consolidating into this whole entire area. You can see here it's creating that gyration, okay? So it's going to be post FOMC. Now remember, usually after FOMC, the price is going to start calibrating in the overnight trading session. And because it's an active earnings season, I don't think that it's going to have, I don't think it's going to need a lot more time, okay? I don't think it's going to need a lot more time, but this would be the forecast. Okay, so for example, all right, so if you're, for example, an overnight trader, this would be where you would stop and say, hey, you know what? I'm going to stop here, because in the overnight trading session is designed to be traded off a little bit higher timeframes, especially the Asian session where you don't have a lot of algorithms, right? So you need a lot more clarity for that. If you are, for example, a day trader, you don't stop here, okay? So you go one step further and you go on the hourly chart as well, okay? And you watch the activity and price action on the hourly chart. You watch the formation of candles. And you can see here that the price is contained between the 50 and the 20 SMA. Now, if you want the price to go higher, it needs to trade above 15,010, okay? So it needs to close. Remember, it needs to close. So the fact that you... The fact that you are just trading peekaboo high and then it can go back down, you need the time sequence to close above the 50 simple moving average, okay? So you need to close above that. All right, so the bottom line is that if you're a day trader, you wanna go deep into a different time frame. So you go into the 15 minute. So for example, if you, are interested into just a small portion, for example, a smaller risk trade, you want to try it and you want to see how the overnight trading session is handling it. Well, now it's 8 o'clock. I highly recommend that you try a 9:30 to 10 o'clock. That's when you're getting a little bit more volume in the market. But as of right now, you know what? You can still do a pretty good analysis. You have support into the 975. Again, you have a bunch of moving averages that are going to put tons of resistance in price. So this is going to be a range. You can see that I'm not drawing the range over these candle highs. No, I'm taking into consideration all of these resistance bands, okay? So if the price is going to poke above the 15,008, it's going to go higher into the prior resistance. This would be your target one. This is how you calculate targets. Target two is going to be into the prior resistance high. So target one, target two, and the price is going to start moving higher. Okay, I don't think that 15,100, 134 is going to be a big deal. So you're going to have targets along the way. So this would be target one, target two, and then target three into the all-time high. Okay, so that would be it. For example, on the scalp side, now, of course, you know, I don't recommend you do any kind of scalping at this time. So I cannot show you exactly a scalp situation, but you can dive in, let's say, on a 2 minute or a 1 minute base. And based upon price action, you could actually look for a scalp. Ideally, you want to see the price outside of the moving averages because that's where and when they get their velocity. At the moment, you could see that the price is still contained into the 50, into the 20 and into the 200 simple moving average. And for those of you that are asking what moving averages am I using, I'm using the 200 simple, the 20 simple, the 50 simple, and the only exponential moving average that I'm using is this 10 exponential moving average right here, the pink one. So how do I identify price action? If this is all that you're going to learn from today's session. So for example, this is let's go to a 1 minute. So it happens a little bit faster, okay? All right, how do I identify price action? How do you determine whether the price is gonna have continuation higher or rejection? You see this candle high right here? The high of this candle is 88.75. If this candle is gonna print an 89, it's going to start going higher, probably to 90, probably to 90. And then if it erases 90, it's going to go a little bit higher. Okay. So let's just start. Let's just watch it for a little bit. We have 1 minute. And then if it breaks this low, the low is 86.25. So it needs to break 86. If it breaks 86, it's going to go into this 20 SMA. The 20 SMA is going to be the decision point. And if it breaks, violates the 20 SMA, it's going to start coming in a little bit more. Okay, here it is. It's violating that. All right, so we have a brand new sequence. This is another 1 minute candle. The low is 86.25. So now this candle, if it breaks below 86 again, this is going to go into the 20 SMA. But here it is. Here it is into the 20 SMA. Now we have 30 more seconds until this candle closes. And if it closes below the 20 SMA, the next candle that is going to form is going to come in again. It's going to get a little bit lower. Okay, so now we have 20 seconds. Just watch it. I'm gonna zoom it in for you guys so you can see it. Okay, we have 20 seconds, 10 seconds, 5. Remember, if it takes out the high, it's going to go into the 200 SMA. All right, and a doji. Now this is decision point again. If it takes out the high, so if it prints 86.75, it needs to print 86.75. It's gonna go higher, all right? If it's going to take out this low, it's going to go lower. It's gonna go up to here, this target one, 87. This would be how you scalp, but you need to have a lot more volume to scalp. You can't scalp in the Asian session. You could do this a lot into the London session. You can do this into the New York trading session. So you could do this a lot. So I really hope you enjoyed reading price action right now. This is kind of like a little bit of inside of how I read price action and how easy it is to identify these levels. Okay. So this would be like the closest action. So now I said that, you know, so what do we do? For example, the last thing that we want to take care of is, let's move on to a 15-minute chart. So the last thing that we want to look at is, for example, what do we do after we close the trade? So let's say we were in a trade. Let's say we were in a trade from earlier, okay, and we made money. And let's say we took another trade later and we lost money, okay? So typically what I do is I zoom in on the technical image and I take two snapshots, okay? I absolutely take two snapshots. You can print them, you know, 20 years ago when I was doing this, I was printing them out. So it was totally different. But now you could, you could snap them, okay? The first thing that you do is you mark the areas where you entered the trade, okay? So you mark the areas where you have entered the trade. So for example, let's say I got in the trade, I don't know, let's pick a place. Let's say I got in here, okay? So I used this entry, I used this stop, okay? So these were my parameters. So let's say I got out of the trade, okay? Let's say I got out of the trade here. Oops, I can't draw. Okay, hold on. All right, let's say I got out of the trade here. Okay, let's say it was a scalp and I got out of the trade here. Okay, so this is my number one trade. I calculate the parameters. So I calculate my entry. Let's say I put my wiggle stop here, right? Let's say my stop was all the way here at the pivot low. I gave it a little bit of room because I knew it was an FOMC meeting, right? And I survived, but I took very little profit, okay? But did I do good? How do you know if you did good or bad, okay? Because I took profit right here into the 200 simple moving average, which is, by the way, this is a really good idea to do. 15 minute 200 simple moving average is always reactive. So you're always going to get some kind of rejection. So from my point of view, it's like, oh yeah, I think I did good. So what you do is you take a snapshot of this. You mark your entry, you mark your stop, and you mark where you exited the trade. Now I'm gonna do it with different colors here so you could see what I'm doing, okay? So on a different sheet of paper, I would do this. Okay, so this was my entry. Oops, sorry. All right. Okay, here it is. All right, so this is my entry. It's basically the same entry, but I'm overlapping it, okay? It's basically the same entry. And I'm looking to see if I would have traded this differently, okay? So still, this is the entry that would have interested me. This is still the, where I really wanna get in. This is exactly where I would have liked to, for example, to place the stop. But I can see here that the price, let's say, it's not really a great example, but I'm gonna try to make it work. So in this example, I could see that I had resistance into, let's say, into the 15.050. And let's say that, you know, I got a little bit scared because of the FOMC meeting and I wanted to cut the trade here. But you can see that the trade went a little bit higher into this point. So at this point, I know what I did, but at this point, I wanted to see, hey, you know what? Based on this formation, I could still have stayed in, because if you see that the price kind of like trended higher, and once it closed above this 200 SMA, it stayed above, it stayed above, it stayed above. And here you can see that this is the time when it turned around. So I basically analyze the difference between where I exited and where I should have exited, right? Because if I would have trailed properly, let's say, I would have had a different entry and I would have had more points, okay? So let's say instead of closing the trade at 15.010, I could have gotten 10 more points, okay? I could have gotten 10 more points, all right? All right, so Chris, it's just an example. It's not about risk to reward here. This is just, it's not the topic for the risk to reward, but it's just an example to see how you can analyze the two, okay? Analyze the two, and especially into an FOMC meeting, okay? All right, I'm gonna show you one other example that we had into the class yesterday. That is actually a really good textbook kind of example. So let me clear this out. All right. So I'm going to take this chart. I'm going to use the same chart. I don't know. I'm going to use the same chart and I'm going to go on this 1 hour. Okay, here we go. All right. So yes, in yesterday's trading session, okay, in yesterday's trading session, we had a divergence in NASDAQ in the sense that we had relative strength in S&P, we had relative strength in YM, but we had weakness in NASDAQ. Oftentimes when big companies report like Alphabet, AMD, Apple, et cetera, traders tend to close the positions right ahead of earnings. It's not always like that, but it seems that that was the case in yesterday's trading session. And that is because they do not want to live through the unexpected, because earnings is definitely a lottery. Nobody knows what the price is going to do except after the fact. So a lot of times you're going to see profit taking. There are also times when the price action rallies. Okay, when the price action rallies. And when the price action rallies into earnings, okay? So there are different cases depending on the market conditions, the environment, you know, whisper numbers. So there are a lot of factors, block trades, dark pools, whatever it is, there are a lot of things that go into this mix. But in yesterday's trading session, we saw that the market came in, and we nailed the bottom. We had actually two bottoms, okay? We had actually two bottoms. We mentioned that we have an interest area at 14,900, which was right here. So at 14,900, we wanted to be buyers, but we didn't have any kind of technical reason to buy because we haven't set any kind of patterns. So I don't trade without any kind of patterns. I don't get in on support and I don't sell at resistance. I could tell you right now. And there is not one institutional trader that does that because they are waiting for confirmations and they're waiting for patterns. Algorithms are looking for power. Algorithms, they're not buying support or selling at resistance or the other way around. They're looking for patterns, strict entry, stop, and pattern. So at this point, as we were trading into the 1900, I wanted to be a buyer. And I saw that, hey, you know what? It's not. So it's releasing a lot more pressure. And I said that 14,800 is going to be the area. Okay. 14,800 is going to be support. How did I reach that decision? I went to my daily chart because I did my pre-market analysis, right? You don't dive in. So if you're a day trader, you don't turn on your computer and go like, let's start trading, guys. Okay, here it is. Here's the 2 minute without knowing what the heck is going on all the other timeframes, because all the other timeframes are going to dictate your directional bias. They're going to dictate support resistance and all that fun stuff. So if you want to have less stops and massive gains, you want to pay attention to multi-timeframe analysis. So based on the daily chart, we have the 10 EMA at 900 and we have the 20 SMA at 800. Okay, we had it here and here. And we knew that we can expect a reaction off of the 10 because oftentimes we had the reaction off of 10, but this time around we came in with a lot more velocity. We didn't have any rotation. I was sitting on my hands, not doing anything. And then bingo, we came into the 20 SMA. Now we know that NASDAQ has a history off of the 20 SMA. So once I knew this level, I immediately went exactly to my hourly chart. It actually went as well to my 30 minute chart because the 30 minute was textbook. 30 minute was literally textbook. Okay. So when I started the class, you could see here that it's 11:30. I started the class at two o'clock. Bing. Oops. Sorry about that. Okay. So let me go back. Okay. Here we go. All right. So where's the arrow? Here it is. Okay. So this is the arrow from 1:30. I was at 1:30. I was getting ready for my class, ready with my slides for my students and all that fun stuff. And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh my gosh, this is an inside bar is elevated from the 10 EMA. This looks like a short squeeze. And then the class started. Okay. And I'm like, forget about teaching. Look at this pattern. Okay. So this is an inside bar. And it went exactly. So when this is a counter trend, and the counter trend, usually counter trend trends are very easy to trade, and they have a really, they provide a pretty good risk to reward ratio. Chris, if you're referring to that, the example before that I have, I just picked on a buy setup. Listen, and it was an FOMC. There is no risk to reward. It was just an example. But for example, in this one, this is your entry, this is your stop. And look how, I did it again. All right, let's go back again. All right, so you can see here that, okay, up into the 10 EMA, knocking over that 10 EMA, creating the velocity for higher, okay? Moving up, all right, see how this 10 EMA is providing a hook for price? Just wait. See what it happened? It came in, it rotated the price velocity. The next target is going to be into the 965, 984. Here it is. You see it? Ta-da! Okay, so yeah, very nice price action and the rest is history. So here you had a really good risk to reward ratio. You pretty much had about three R trade. It was an impeccable trade. It was based on price action, location, precise location. So that's what I'm trying to say is that a lot of times day traders live in the wrong time frame. They live on small time frames. They ignore what happens on larger time frames. So now that I showed you all this, I hope that you have enjoyed today's session. So like I said, for the overnight trading session, we have to digest the FOMC high and the FOMC low. If we trade above the FOMC high, we're going to go higher. Below the FOMC low, we're going to try to retest this low right here. So it can be traded cautiously to the short side from 900 to about 800. And then if we go to the upside, like I said, once it clears around 1525 or so, then we can look for more upside. So if you guys want to trade with me, we do trade every single day in the trading room. We explain the trades as they happen, and we are very conservative in our approach. We only like to look for very high caliber trades. We look for trades that have really good chance of continuation higher. I trade any kind of market environment, volatile, choppy, sideways, quadruple witch option expiration, whatever it is. And I trade anything. So a chart is a chart. So if you guys want to trade with me, Dan, of course, send me an email. I do run a trading room. The trading room is really easy to follow. So I prepared the pre-market game plan, is ready for you guys. You're pretty much going to see a lot of, a lot of levels. Let me show you some examples from the trading session today. Let's go here. Do you guys see these six charts? Okay. All right. So I don't have anything here because I deleted the NASDAQ, but you can see here that we have very clean, areas that if we, for example, today, bullish above, you can see here that the bullish above area came into a fulfillment at 4:30 at FOMC. It went exactly into the high velocity and then it came back down. You can see here, for example, in YM, we had a bullish above area. Okay, here. And by the way, today we had a really nice, juicy day. We had a profitable day. We were done early. So you're always going to have bullish above, bearish below levels. Let's see here, let's see the 15 minute. Okay. So see here, we had a bullish above, see this congestion here post FOMC. This was the breakout. So this was the biggest breakout. So you could actually take advantage of all the data that I post in the trading room. And you could, you could trade these levels on your own in the afternoon trading session, if that's what you want to do. The trading room is open from 9:30 until 11, from 9:30 till 12 o'clock every single day. If we're done early at 10 o'clock or 10:30, I shut it down. Like, why sit in front of the computer, right? If you want to trade the extended session, take some snapshots of these charts and you have the levels, you can trade them with confidence. The trading room is also 100% guided. So what that means is that I call the entry, I call the stop, and I, on the mic, second by second by second, literally by second, I'm trailing the trade for you. Hey, Tammy. Yeah, thanks. Okay. So if you guys are interested in the TradeOutLoud trading room, you could actually, start, your subscription. Trust me, even if it's for a month or two or three or four, 6 months, you're going to learn a lot of things. We have traders that, started with us. They started to learn a little bit with us. And then they go like, oh my gosh, I want to go deep and learn this system, because you can trade anything on the planet with it. You can trade cryptos. You can trade anything. Forex, you could trade stocks. Stocks is going to be like a walk in a park with our methodology. So I do have a bonus for you, for those of you that are subscribing tonight. So the price is still $299, but we're going to give you access to a risk size video, position sizing video, which is the most important thing of trading, because that is going to make or break your account if you don't know how to position size. There are so many misconceptions in the futures market. For example, if you have let's say a $50,000 account, I'm going to trade five contracts, okay? A standard of five contracts. Or I have $20,000 account, I'm going to trade a standard of two contracts, which is completely wrong. So it's 100% wrong. So you have to take into consideration that. Okay, position size. The position size is very important. It's a 1 hour course. It's a video course. You learn how to do it, and it's applicable to any market, stock market, futures market, etc. All right, guys, this is all for tonight. My time is up. Hope you had a really great educational experience tonight. I would love to hear your feedback. If you can email me your ideas, or if you want to hear about a different topic, chart discussion, I would highly, highly, highly accommodate that for you. So thanks so much, everyone. I will see you next time. And I'll see you in the trading room tomorrow at 9 o'clock. Very excited. We're closing a super massive, massive, strong month again. Today, we also closed a trade in copper. It trailed out at $4.50. We had some really good targets into it. And we had a really great month, another positive month. So thanks so much, everyone. I will see you guys. Where's the link? Oops, I'm not a very good salesperson. Maurice, yeah. Talk to me about trading, not links, right? Okay, here's the link, guys. Hey, Lori, thank you. Okay, so here's the link if you guys want to join the trading room. You know, I do explain every single step that I take, you know, a lot more education in there. You know, we have fun. It's always nice. Okay, so thanks so much, everyone. I will see you guys in the trading room tomorrow. Let's close this month super strong, not strong, super strong, with extraordinary results. Thanks so much, guys. See you next time.